Hello, everyone. Welcome to MoMA's Virtual Cinema. My name is La Francis Hui. I am a film curator here, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to the discussion of Nomadland. Before we get started, I'd like to acknowledge Chanel, the lead sponsor of MoMA's film programming, and I also want to thank our members. And if you are not yet a member, I hope that you will consider joining us. I'm very excited to have with me the creative team behind this sublime work of art. I'm really happy to have all of you, and let me introduce everyone. Chloé Zhao, writer, director, editor, producer of the film. Joshua James Richards, director of photography, and he's also in charge of production design. And Sergio Diaz, supervising sound editor and sound designer. And Zach Sievers, supervising sound editor and re-recording mixer. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
Thank you, La.
I'm going to begin with Chloé. This film is based on a nonfiction book by Jessica Bruder named Nomadland, Surviving America in the 21st Century. Some of the characters in your film are real life individuals playing themselves. Most notably, Linda May, Swanky, Bob Wells. It is not unusual for you to work within the border of fiction and nonfiction, and you have made narrative films with non-professionals playing characters very much like themselves. Can you talk about how you turned this book into a fiction work and how you imagined it for cinema?
The book has such a scale to it. Jessica spent years researching, and she really captured a time in this country, in the United States, where a way of life was disappearing for a generation, the life they know it. So we, from the very beginning, wanted to be able to have that scale. It isn't just about one person's personal journey. Of course, that will be the spine that keep the audience invested. But through her journey, we wanted to be able to touch on so many people's lives and places, like Empire, Nevada, for example, and Corside, Arizona, and these places and the stories that Jessica found there. So the way we went about it is to how do we create a fictional character and a fictional arc that can give us that scale.
Mm. And the creation of the fictional character Fern, I should note that it's the first time you work with movie stars, Frances McDormand and David Strathairn. Mm. They blend so seamlessly into the film. Can you talk about the writing of these characters and also how the stars worked with the rest of the cast?
Yeah, if you're really lucky, you get to work with actors who, as Fran would probably put it, aren't afraid to make a fool of themselves in front of the camera. And they're willing to be open and vulnerable and live the moment in front of the camera. It's not an easy thing to do. And for the two of them who, you know, have so much experiences and crafts, to be able to put that aside in moments if it didn't fit exactly what they planned, and to still be extremely human in that moment and connect with a non-professional actor. We knew going in, if they weren't actors that are capable of doing that and enjoy doing that, we would have a problem. So we knew that going in, they, having met them, spent a lot of time with them, we knew that could work. And also, writing their character to incorporate versions of themselves into it as well, because that's how the non-professional actors will be written. That was also important.
Mm. I want to ask all of you about the research process. When you met with this community of nomads, wanderers, travelers, however you want to call them, and also you looked at and listened to the landscape, the soundscape, the environment. What did you discovered and considered essential to capture for this film?
Josh? You know the answer to that one.
What was essential to capture with Nomadland? Was certainly this emotional landscape is how I would put it with Nomadland, and tracing Fern's journey through these different locales and the way Chloé incorporated the landscape into the script as a kind of window into Fern's emotional journey. That was, I think, what was most essential in the approach visually. And these are also places that we'd gotten to know over quite a long period of time and wanted to explore more cinematically. So that was important to us.
And you have like a whole range of terrain and the color of the sky is always changing, the light is different. How did you look at all these elements?
I think by embracing them, I think, and finding ways of tying them into the language of Nomadland, because you are at the mercy of the elements, but also we scout very carefully. And so you begin to feel the kind of palette and character of the movie, during prep. But it's what I enjoy about how Chloé wants to make films, because it's one day is never the same, La. So I really enjoy working this way because it constantly means you have to think outside of yourself. You have to sort of throw out your little rule book of cinematography and often make best of an unpredictable situation. And we found in Chloé's films that usually those mistakes can also bring forth great jewels, gifts along the way.
Did you wait for the right time of the day? Because there's a lot of sunset and sunrise is beautiful color. And was it more improvisational or it's more planned?
That part's very planned. Chloé and I, Chloé is also, you schedule the movie, don't you, Chloé, very carefully around the light. And for a cinematographer, it's an absolute joy because often there isn't time for that or a filmmaker doesn't prioritize that. But Chloé does, and we create very planned windows in which more spontaneous things can happen. But in regards to light, that part is very carefully scheduled.
And how about the soundscape, Sergio and Zach?
Yeah, from my perspective, when we talk about art, any discipline of art, painting, poetry, photography, cinema, everything is about perception. And from my point of view, we dive in into the thin line between fiction and nonfiction in Nomadland, cinematography language. So it was a good chain of collaboration sound-wise, because the decisions that they do during the set, during the shooting, was very remarkable because my wolf start creating a lot of layers of sounds that contribute with the post-production process. So what I did was create a strong concept that I call it fragility, no? Mm-hmm. And I divided my concept in three categories to have this approach to the film with prominent sound, serenity sound, and using specific silence, but very focused on the organic way. So we avoid all the non-specific sounds for that purpose. So the idea was to bring everything organic and authentic. So we start adding more layers or specific winds, rain, snow, fire, all that kind of elements that can contribute to the to the story and preserve the original idea, because Chloé was very precise since the very beginning. So we were focused on that. And then we passed the sessions to Zach to improve and enhance the soundscape in that direction.
Yeah, but it's all basically a trickle down from the original idea that Chloé establishes and that Joshua then expands on through the way that he films it, and it just carries through. Mike Wolf, Sergio mentioned, was the production sound mixer who recorded all of the dialogue. He also recorded additional sound effects, which is not common for production sound mixers, but he was enabled and empowered to do that by Chloé, to go in and record these spaces so beautifully. And then obviously, so Sergio then is able to add another layer of nuance through the sound design and through picking and choosing these very specific design textures, which then by the time it gets to me, I'm really the last person who creatively gets to touch the film. And it's a really exciting process because it's all, I'm really the beneficiary of all the work that's been done up until that point. And it's really a matter of making those final choices as to how we're going to focus the narrative and balance the world of the film and the sonic landscape with the music, which is a whole other component that adds so much emotion to the film.
I'll tell you what, one of the biggest challenge for the producers is to make sure we don't accidentally leave Wolf behind, because he's wandered off to record these beautiful sound, and he's so passionate about sound, and he's in this natural environment, and he just gets into it, and he walked off, and then we have to check, is Wolf with us? No, let's go find him.
Because on a practical level with making films like this, Lyle, there is a lot of waiting around on any film set, but specifically with Nomadland, a lot of just being out there in the desert, waiting on the light, you know, sort of integrating yourself into the world. So you really have to have a crew that's willing and wants to do that. Mm-hmm. And it's all the way through. And with Wolf, he's a boom operator that we inherited from our previous film, The Rider. And he's just the same kind of filmmaker as us. And he wants to immerse himself in the world in the same way. And it shows in the sound.
Yeah, and if you're lucky, you want, when you make a film like this, you want every crew member to be curious. Mm. You want to bring on this journey people who are as curious about life as you are, because the contribution they're going to do, many times they bring me a cast member, you know, they found in the desert because they start talking to them, or they see an older woman with a lot of rings on her hands turned out to be such an important moment in the film with the grandma talking about people call you nomads. You know, so it's not a one person's world building job, because it's a lot when you're out there. And now you have 22 pair of ears and eyes listening.
Because some filmmakers, you know, some approaches to filmmaking, you know, you build shots, you know, on the stage, for example, you know, you create the mise-en-scene and you light it and you build the images, whereas we find shots. Mm. You know, we're always searching for them, and Chloe's always searching for story as well and character, and yeah, it's that constant sort of search, I think, that keeps you going, I guess.
A couple of days ago, I watched this film a second time in my department screening room, so that I could enjoy the immersive environment and to hear the sound properly, obviously. And it is a privilege I have working at MoMA and during this pandemic. It's striking how gentle, delicate, and sensitive the film is. I told a colleague that it is like feather. It's like you want to breathe very softly. Nobody shouts or talks loud. The sound is soft. The music is quiet. There's no jerky movement, no drama. And we know about the harsh circumstances some of these folks are in, but the film doesn't dwell on hardship, injustice, or pain. And even if I feel moved or sad, I just think that crying might just be too disturbing. I wonder how the team talked about this gentleness, this delicate piece of work, which required every department to contribute.
Yeah, from my perspective, it's an emotional journey. So since the very beginning, I was connected with the film, with the structure and the language, specific language of cinematography, and the way that they tell the story. So what we do is we're basically create a tapestry of colors, textures, and deepness with the soundscape to reach the audience and have this kind of connection, emotional journey. Because for me, this is very, very personal and very delicate. All those human interactions, long takes, landscapes, that's the beauty of Nomadland. So the idea was to bring and more ideas on the decks to contribute with the story.
Anyone?
Zach,
please go.
For me, I think, you know, the first time I talked to Chloe about the project, we barely talked about the film. I talked about my personal experiences, some things that I'd gone through with my mom, things that she had gone through. There were things about Fern's character that resonated with me based on those personal experiences. And I feel like as artists, we bring, you know, those personal experiences to the choices that we make. And I think a lot of the delicate nature of it, whether it's the softness of the music and how it eases into a scene and how we don't want to force the emotional, you know, arc of the film onto the audience. We want the audience to be able to fall into the scene and to really be able to appreciate what Fern is going through in her journey. You know, you have to have a sensitivity towards that character story to be able to then know just instinctively how loud or soft something should be, and knowing when it's appropriate to make the spatialization, you know, or the three-dimensional components of the sound more prominent, or to let those things step back. There's a scene towards the end of the film or the middle of the film when Swanky is letting go of a lot of her personal objects. And the sound design takes a step back in that moment. It really becomes more of a musical moment. And we hear just little bits of dialogue, just enough to get a sense of, you know, what people are picking through and what they find. And I feel like Chloe's direction was always extremely clear in terms of how we were going to let each of those components drive each scene. And we brought individually our own perspective to try to make it a cohesive experience. But I appreciate that you feel that it is like a feather, because, you know, when you're listening to it in a theater, it does feel immersive in the sense that you lean into the film, not that it feels bombastic. And that's very important for this kind of a film, I think.
And the whole time we were filming Nomadland, you know, during that season and during our journey, do you remember, Chloe, we were followed by swallows. You know, and it was amazing. It was like Swanky's swallows were kind of with us. And I think we even filmed swallow nests and things along the way. It didn't make it, but the idea of the delicacy, and I always saw Fern, you know, these nomads almost like those swallows, you know, that kind of, I mean, from a visual point of view, the delicacy is also in, you know, how to gently support the performances that Chloe was going for, you know, and sort of creating a safe space around that working environment. That's really what led a lot of the choices in the camera department, which affects the visual language of the film. The two things are connected.
Yeah.
As you can see, my team likes to give me a lot of credit. But you know, my job is really, you know, attracting the right people into this project. Because once you do that, casting the right people, casting the right group, bringing the right talent, that's about, I would say, 70% job done. You know, so then starts with friend being friend, and then Josh being Josh, and that create the image, and then Zach and Sergio being who they are. And then they almost immediately they understand that organism is in harmony.
That's cool. Because I'm going to give Chloé more credit, because the way she's always create relationships first, you know, and then the work comes out of that. I think it's important, because at the end of the day, that's what's going to define your life, isn't it? The relationships that we make along the way. And you feel it in the writing, and you feel it in the way the film is made, all the way to the end when it reaches Zach.
You mentioned Swallow, so I do want to bring up that scene with Swanky when she talks about her experiences on the road. She talks about having lived a good life and witnessing the beauty of nature and the world. A pelican landed on a kayak, the swallows and the reflection on the water. It seems so documentary, that moment. It's magical and impromptu. How's that scene made? And obviously, I also want to know what happened to her.
She's just fine.
She's
right now parked pretty much exactly where we filmed her, where she claimed that part of the desert to be Swanky Lane. Yeah, she's good. She's fine. And I think, you know, like it's every fictional film director's dream for you to enter a scene and think it's real, right? That's what we're going for. And I think the process is not that different than making a more conventional fictional film, which is we go out there, we do a research of this type of person we want to put in the film. We meet her and she tells us a lot about her lives. And one of the first things Swanky told us is about her kayaking across America and describing these things to us. And having done two films, there is a bit of a training in us to kind of listen to that moment and go, oh, that's the essence of this person, that the character I'm looking for. And therefore I tape that and then I put it into a script. And that's where it starts to split up from a more conventional film. They can cast a professional actor who do their own research and say those lines. And in our case, we cast a person to do it. So on that day, she would need anybody that can beat her will have to be some of the best method acting actors you can find out there. Early on in my career, I couldn't afford that. So I've learned to cast a real thing. And that's why on that day, Swanky might go off a little bit, but she knew exactly what where the sandbox, the edges are. And within that, she can play to give us even more feeling of being in the moment and authenticity.
Mm. Yeah, just to add to that, because we've realized somehow that when you are this idea of authenticity and true performance, I just think of myself, La, because if you said to me, Josh, we're going to film you, all you have to do is just be yourself, I have no idea what that means. Once you put a camera on me, what do you mean be myself? All I can be is Josh being filmed by a camera. I can give you that. But anything else would be acting. However, if you said, bear with me here, but if you said, well, no, Josh, we've written a script and you're playing a character. If you give me that mask to hide behind, you know what? I might actually be able to give you more of myself. in front of the camera.
And also telling you specifically which part of yourself I want you to be. Without that, yeah, you would not even be documentary, it would just be a YouTube videos of a daily blog.
Because we know that everything's behavior changes when it's being observed.
Mm.
So with that in mind, how do we get Swanky to really give us that moment that she gave us when we first met her? And so Chloé, there's, you know, people need a mask to wear, I think, to really be themselves. That's what we've found as this sort of fictional approach pertains to capturing truth.
It is interesting because sometimes in a performance, you feel freer to be yourself because you don't have to feel like shy or embarrassed because you're performing.
Yeah, and it's not, you know, when we say like a documentary is the truth, well, no, it isn't. It's always an edited version with a sort of subjectivity to it. So yes, when Chloé allows Swanky to play a role, she doesn't have to feel that she has to have so much, you know, like she doesn't have to give you the true Swanky. She doesn't have that responsibility. She's free to be. Chloé always described it as community theater. To collaborate.
Well, I can't be I don't have the guts to be a documentary filmmaker. That's gutsy. I can never do what they do. And being on the reservation for made for two films there, I found it much easier for me to work with the kids when I know they're pretending to play somebody else or a version of themselves that is acting, even though there might be, you know, obviously we know the healing power of theater, of community theater. And we also know how important it is to watch someone performing, not just necessarily being themselves, but performing a character and how that's been in our psyche since the beginning, you know, and I think being on the reservation, getting to know those kids, like seeing them to be able to hide behind the allegory or hide behind a pretend character and then showing something dark and vulnerable they wouldn't otherwise show to a news camera. Those are very satisfying experiences in my early career.
I imagine that the production had to adapt to improvised moments and scenarios. Can you guys talk about instances, if any, when you had to alter your plans or when your actors went off script? And how did you embrace chance encounters and the interjection of real life?
It's like any great road trips, right? Like things are gonna happen. The best kind is that if you plan to a point that you know everything you could imagine happen would happen. And then when you get on the road and when things do happen, you could truly enjoy it and take advantage of it. A good example would be that scene where she's on the cliff when the hurricane hit. It's not easy to come flying that. We knew she was gonna have a scene on the beach. Josh was quite worried about how serene the beach feels, you know, like we got there, we go, that's not gonna invoke emotion in that moment. She can't leave Dave's house and walk onto the beautiful sunset on the California beach. That's just not gonna work. And we were hoping for some bad weather, and we didn't expect one of the worst in a long time. You know, people, National Geographic sent photographers in for that moment. But we were ready in no time. As soon as the storm hit, almost before I even said it, everyone knew by that then Chloé's gonna want to shoot there. The preparation was already in process. And we were there in less than 20 minutes, or we would have missed the hurricane. And once we get there, no one can hear each other.
Mm.
We all knew how we're going to shoot. And the camera is the most important thing. And everyone's there protecting the camera and the cast. It's just really, even me had to step away. It's about Josh and Fran in that moment.
I think another good example, Chloé, shows how there's moments that are kind of like whole scenes and situations that are semi-improvised in a sense, like with with Derek, for example, he was the train hopping kid that Fern meets by the fireplace. And we found Derek during filming, you know, during the shooting. Chloé had a character in mind that was a girl to begin with. But then when we found Derek, he's this, you know, real modern day Huckleberry Finn, and we just had to get him in the movie. And Derek doesn't really know, Derek's never been in front of camera before. He doesn't really know what's going on. And I just think had we done a long casting call and a big process of finding a young actor like that, by the time they arrive on the set and everything's happened, I don't know, something's been lost. Whereas with Derek, he was fresh from the road. I mean, that's real dust in his paws. And that's real, those hands have been hopping trains for 4 years. And so to capture that on camera was one of the privileges of Nomadland for me.
Not as fun when you start editing, but Derek is just a very short version of that. So then the night before, tell me about yourself, a lot is said. And then you still pick the bits that you want him to say. And then he would go off a lot, and we'll get like a 45 minutes take on him. And then Frank gets one take because the light would run out. And then in the edit, you're like, oh, yes, we have a scene. Yeah, there's risk you're taking for sure.
So you are basically revising your screenplay along the way. And how did that Shakespeare sonnet came into that part of with Derek when Fern recites it?
Again, the benefit of working with an actress who is willing to go with the flow, like go with how you want to create this character, and not knowing, again, it wasn't easy for Fern not knowing who this character is from the very beginning before she's prepping. We didn't know she was gonna recite a sonnet in the film. We didn't know, we barely knew she was a teacher, you know, at that time. And as we went earlier, I think right before we start shooting, we kind of go, oh, maybe, you know, she taught in school, because she taught theater to the kids, because Fran went to acting school and she did like Shakespeare summer company. She even auditioned, didn't get in. We even filmed little scenes between her and Swanky, where Swanky ends the scene, goes, well, not everyone can make it. And she's telling Swanky's her acting dreams, you know. So there's just how much can we play with the truth and fiction there. So along the way, we knew she was a teacher, and then taught Shakespeare and theater. And we did a scene in the sporting goods store with the girl who also quoted Shakespeare. And we thought, okay, well then that felt really good. And let's go a little further, because we want to come out of Fran's voice. And then also the playing Fran, Fern, you know, how much Fran is Fern. And we all know Frances McDormand can do Shakespeare. And it's just how playful do you want to be, you know? And then having an actress with game go, okay, well, guess now my character does that. And then just embrace it, instead of being like there's a character has to be created right before we start shooting. And the character grow with us as we film. It's a road movie, right? We discover ourselves on the road. And we all kind of did, so is Fern. The character within the movie and also the character that we're creating. It was a journey of discovery for everyone involved.
Mm. I think it is fair to say that most people don't know this community very well. We have not come across these people. Cinema has the magic of connecting people and experiences, because I mean, we believe human beings are fundamentally similar. We look for beauty, happiness. But I think this film takes that connection to a very different level. We seem to be looking at something very profound. Perhaps it is the magnificent landscape, the sky, the poetry, the inner peace, the freedom of the road. They all kind of come together to form a spiritual union. I wonder if you guys talked about this spiritual connection and how to convey that cinematically.
Yeah, from my perspective, it's an spiritual aura indeed. That's what I feel since the very beginning. So, and everything makes sense throughout the emotional connection with the audience. So for, I believe in the simplicity treatment could be more emotional or have more impact with the audience, which is our main goal as a sound artist now behind the scenes, to improve every single shot, the director's idea, and preserve the structure in that line. So yeah, it for us was simple. Less is more in this kind of language. So I believe in the it was challenging because we have to collect the specific sounds to contribute with that purpose. So yeah, basically for me was an spiritual aura. Every one of us, we have this connection, telepathic connection, because we did everything remotely. That's the another intimacy in another way. So that's what I'm so proud and happy to be part of this beautiful piece of art.
There's such a depth created there, Lauren, like what Sergio was talking about, that was so, I mean, the spirit, I don't know what you think, Chloe, but the spirituality thing, I don't know we can take credit for, or the sense of that feeling, that texture that you're referring to, that kind of sense of these, like, there are these grace moments that obviously you feel, I felt in the script, and the script was like a feather, you know, a little flame that you're like scared you could just blow out. It was very delicate. And so I felt that responsibility to, when it's that delicate, the visual language needs to remain emotional, but then it can't sort of overwhelm the film either, you know, it can't put anything between you and Fern's character. And I suppose from my perspective, I always felt this, when we were filming these moments, I felt what you're referring to. And I was amazed at how Chloe found the language in the edit also to make the audience then feel those moments. You know, you're hoping by shooting in a certain kind of light, by having a certain dogma and a certain dedication to just authenticity with no bullshit, and then hope that the poetry is there in the locations and then the natural light. And that's all you can kind of hope for as a cinematographer. And then it was really the language that Chloe found, I think, that took Nomadland to that sort of different plane, if you like.
Yeah, I think we all, Joshua just mentioned authenticity. We keep using that word because we're really trying to be true to the humanity in the film. And I feel like there's just so much in these characters that resonates. There's so many universal feelings that you have when you see what they're going through, and that you want Fern to be able to have, you want her to reach a point of catharsis. You want her to be able to reach a point that she's able to transform and grow past the past experiences that she's gone through, and she does that. And to me, it's always been one of the great things about the film, is that it teaches us that no matter how old you are, you can go through so much loss and still at the end of that journey, learn something and continue to grow. And I feel like, you know, whether it's the sound of a specific wind or it's the way that we, you know, choose to integrate Ludovico Einaudi's music into a scene, all of those choices, we start from that place of wanting to be true to that humanity and that journey.
I want to ask something. It's interesting that we look at the stars and the wonder of nature and one would call creation, and yet there is no mention of faith and God. I'm just curious whether it's something you ever thought about.
Every day.
I always say, that's
okay, go on.
Well, I always say that in Terrence Malick's films, like, God exists, but in Chloe Zhao films, paganism is real.
Now put those two names in the same sentence. I don't deserve.
But you know what I'm saying. You know.
It's, yeah, I'll explain that a little bit. what he meant was, yes, and I think Josh, I can't believe you just said that. Okay. No, it's funny. It's funny because
there's a transcendence in there's a truth in nature in certain cinema, and then there's a faith in something higher in certain cinema. And I know where Nomadland lies.
Yeah. I think it's what he meant paganism is because I just was raised as an atheist in China, because you know it was like that when I was raised. And so it's very difficult for me to wrap my head around organized religion. I just can't, I totally appreciate people who are part of it. I just can't get with it. But when I didn't have religion growing up, when you get older, I wasn't joking when I said I wake up and think about it every day. Why am I here? Why do we die? Why do we live? You know, all those questions. And so then where do you go? And you can go to indigenous religions, and I look back at my own country, the Chinese philosophy, you look at the philosophy from Western civilization, and then also there is paganism, there's the time when we used to talk to trees and when we used to feel like we're no different than an animal before we're told that we're evolved. You know, I think, so then in Terry's films, we see an aspect of that. And then in our films, I think we fully explore that.
Yeah, because there's also such a respect for the landscape in Chloe's films, and that's how we approach the movies too. And with regard to like this idea of death, I mean, that was the idea with the light as well, that, you know, there's always this sort of Western glow on the horizon that seems to be fading. You know, these people are in the twilight of their life. And then that was the other thing that always really came through to me, Lara, was that there's such dignity in that though. You know, and I think that's what moves me so much about the film. It's sort of a film about human dignity, and there is no need for big incident in the movie because they're facing the biggest challenge that any living creature will, and that's their own mortality. You know, and the film doesn't shy away from sort of looking into that. And I think it's something we probably would be healthier doing in our Western culture, you know, a more healthy perspective on death.
Well, I kind of feel like we have just begun to speak, but I know that you actually have to run off in 2 minutes. Have the folks in the film seen the film? How did they feel about it?
Yeah, they have. A lot of them were at the Rose Bowl when we premiered the drive-in screening, and that was such a treat for all of us. I think they're really proud and really, really excited and quite impressed with their own performances.
That's great.
He's the official manager of our Facebook page, like our Facebook crew page. So she updates all the reviews, all the critics stuff, the awards. Like, I didn't even know if we win something. Frankie will let us know. And she will find all the little quotes they had about herself and show it to me. It's great.
Well, I wish you guys good luck. I hope that people get to see it in theaters. It's a little bit difficult right now, but this is something that's important. I feel like the theater kind of mimics the experience of this community. You are completely alone in the dark, but yet there's this sense of togetherness. And I think it's important.
If you're safe, if you feel safe and comfortable, the IMAX theaters are much bigger. Please go see. You can also get to see the full frame. You're not going to see it online. So.
I do want to show you that I have your Tumblr.
I love it.
I think we can safely say that see you down the road.
See you down the road.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.